Good morning. I mean, on such a sunny, wonderful sunny morning, it's hard to feel Lentish, but it is the fifth Sunday of Lent. Welcome to worship this morning at Lorraine Avenue Mennonite Church. It is important to gather together, to be together in worship in the presence of God in person or on Zoom. Join me now in the call to worship as it's printed in your bulletin. I will read the one and you will read the all. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel. No longer will they teach their neighbors or say to one another, "Know the Lord," because they will all know me, from the least to the greatest.
This new covenant
is being offered to us. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds.
Death must come before resurrection. A seed fallen to the soil and broken open can become life for many.
This new covenant is being offered to us to lay down our life and follow. The life-giving ways of God placed within our minds and written on our hearts, where we are forgiven and our sins are remembered no more. Where we are God's people and God is our God. Pastor Christina will lead us in a time of confession.
Good morning. We will be singing Hold Me God, which by now, hopefully you know. But if not, it should be stuck in your hymnal somewhere. It looks like this. And we'll sing that once through. We'll pray the prayer of confession. And before the assurance of pardon, we'll sing just the Kyrie eleison. Have a moment, a bit of silence, and then I will read the assurance of pardon. Let us sing, Hold Me, God.
O God, we gather before you, seeking your mercy. Hear us, we pray. We confess that we sin against you. O God, wash us, make us clean, create in us a new spirit. Hear us, we pray. Stay close to us, restore us to your truth, so that we can cry out with joy, cleansed in your abundant mercy. O God, draw near to us, grant us grace, hear us, we pray. We hear from the prophet Isaiah, "Who will condemn me? It is the sovereign Lord who helps me. My God who vindicates me is near. Who then will bring charges against me?" Friends, God draws near to us and helps us. In the name of Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. I invite you to pass the peace with one another, and I have a new way this week. It being the month of Ramadan, I thought I might teach you how to say peace be with you as our Arabic-speaking neighbors do. And that would be assalamu alaikum, assalam, alaikum. And I don't know the response very well. I could sort of mumble through it, malaikum salam, but you can just say assalam alaikum, and that just means peace be with you. So pass the peace. Assalam alaikum. Pass the peace with one another.
We're going to sing when the kids come up. While the children come forward for a time with Kathy McAlpin, let's sing number 511, Come On, Children, to the Gospel Feast. Come on, children, to the gospel feast. Gather round, all are welcome to the gospel feast. Gather round, this is where we sing and pray. Read God's word on this glad day. Come on, children, to the gospel feast. Gather round.
Today, I want to talk to you about donkeys.
Thank you, children and Kathy. This is our opportunity to worship with our offerings, which we can put in the collection plate in the back of the sanctuary, give our donations by PayPal, or mail them in.
Thank you.
Jesus of love and leftovers, we struggle with what to share and how much is enough. Sometimes we are the disciples quietly suggesting that you send the needy crowds away. Sometimes we are the crowds bringing only our desire to be close to you. When we have little, embolden us to share it. When we have nothing, welcome us to stay and eat. In giving and receiving, we participate in the miracle of enough. Thank you, Jesus. Let us join together in singing hymn number 428, Praise with Joy the World's Creator. You may stand in body or in spirit, number 428. Our scripture reading this morning is from the book of John, chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. I don't know what page that is in our pew Bible, but it's after Luke. Okay. Just as Jesus lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who hate evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Amen.
I As we have journeyed through Lent these last several weeks, we have asked, along with the disciples, the Jewish leaders of the day, and the crowds, who is this Jesus guy anyway? This Son of Man, the human one, is certainly a prophet and a teacher, certainly a miracle worker, and even a bit of a rabble-rouser. Remember John 2, the so-called cleansing of the temple a few weeks ago. He weaves stories of lost things, as we heard last week, of sheep and coins and sons. And according to Peter's declaration that we heard right at the beginning of Lent in Mark 8, he is the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One. Let us pray. Christ, we believe in you. We ask that you help our unbelief. Christ, we know you love the world. Help us to love it as well. Amen. Now, this Christ, the Anointed One, is perhaps the clearest, it's the clearest that Jesus is supposed to be the Christ in the book of John. Because we have insight into this community that is asking this question as well, and we have a book that was written kind of after some other things had shook out. It has a pretty strong theological agenda, the book of John. Jesus is the light of the world, capital L, capital world. By contrast, those who live in the dark are against Jesus, right? We talked about this with the cleansing of the temple. There's this binary view of the world, light, dark, spirit, flesh, life, death. That dominates the book of John. But interestingly, it is not set in stone. Take the most famous verse of this passage, perhaps of the whole Bible. For God so loved the world. The world in the book of John is sometimes a stand-in for those who do not believe. In John 1, verse 10, Jesus, he was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. Or in John 15, Jesus says to his disciples, "If the world hates you, be aware that it hated me before it hated you." Yet according to John 3, God loves the world. Jesus comes into the world, as this chapter and others indicate, not to destroy it, but to save it, not to judge, not to condemn. The binary that even the book of John presents, even within the book, it doesn't hold up. It is being bridged. It is being troubled. But then, of course, there's that kind of heartening piece of this chapter. And then we find another binary almost immediately. Those who believe and those who do not believe and perish. Or those who love darkness more than light. Those who come to the light and do what is true. We are right back to this binary view of things. So what is it that's going on here? Well, it's helpful, I think, to remember that the binary language of John is primarily a rhetorical device. He's making a point and using particular language to get that point across. As we see, the world, usually bad, in this passage, God loves it. The binaries are not as strict as it might seem. Why would the binary between those who believe and those who do not, those who love the light and those who hate the light, be any stricter than this modified binary that we see in 3:16? The Gospel of John is making a rhetorical point. Or, to put it a different way, one might ask after reading this passage, which is it? Does God love the whole world? Or is it only everyone who believes who can be saved? And to that I say, it's probably both. The temptation with this passage is to condemn non-Christians or those who just reject what we consider the gospel altogether. And that's, I guess we could. But I hear it as a bold message to those of us who claim to love the light. Near the end of the passage, Jesus declares, All who do wicked things hate the light and don't come to the light for fear that their actions will be exposed to the light. They act a certain way if they don't love the light. Do we act like we love the light? Do we love the world as God loves the world? And are we willing to follow Jesus as he is lifted up? This gets us all the way back to the beginning of the passage that Kathy read. Jesus says in John 3:14 that he will be lifted up as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness. Now, that's a reference to the book of Numbers chapter 21, a passage I'm sure you're all very familiar with. It's a confusing passage about God sending snakes to attack the grumbling Israelites as they wander in the wilderness. I found out this week that the word for the snakes, they're poisonous snakes, but it might also mean they were fiery snakes, which is very scary. This idea of fiery snakes attacking Israelites in the wilderness. I don't know what that means. Maybe the bite felt fiery. But anyhow, so the Israelites, they're being attacked by snakes. And when they repent of their grumbling, God has Moses make a bronze snake and lift it up on a pole. And the Israelites who are bitten must look up at that which hurt them, and they are healed. I don't have a lot to say about this passage today. I think it's a discussion for another day. It's odd. But what is important is that Jesus is emphasizing that he will be lifted up and bring salvation, just like that bronze snake did. Now, in the book of John, lifted up comes up a few times. The next time is in John 8:28, and then again in John 12:32, and I believe that we'll be talking about that lifted up next week. And it's a double entendre. Jesus will be lifted up on the cross and will be lifted up in the resurrection and ascension. As we said in the call to worship this morning, there has to be death before resurrection. This lifted up language, in some ways we could focus on the nice being lifted up in the ascension and resurrection, but it is still Lent, so let us focus on the less pleasant part, the lifting up on the cross. I'm reminded again of Mark 8. If any wish to come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Are we willing to be lifted up as Jesus was? Are we willing to take up our cross as Jesus did? Do we act like we love the light? The way of the cross is not easy. The way of the cross involves exposing ourselves to the light, kind of like how we do in confession. We allow ourselves and we commune with God and take a good look at what in our life needs to maybe be cleaned out. The way of the cross involves seeing and acknowledging all of the bad stuff, all the stuff we're bogged down by, and truly turning, truly changing, truly repenting. The way of the cross is foolishness when compared to the way of the world. The foolishness of caring for the least of these. The foolishness of loving a world even when it hates us. The way of the cross ends in humiliation. But of course it also ends in resurrection and salvation. The binary will not hold. We will follow the light and we will seek after God's forgiveness. We will sometimes be in the dark, and we might learn something about God there too. And we'll sometimes think that the world is evil and be ready to give up on it. And then the next day we will discover it too is full of grace and is loved by God. We will look up to the cross as the Israelites looked up to the bronze snake in the wilderness, as the Israelites did while they were wandering and confused and scared. But we will constantly seek the way that our God has laid out for us. May we have the courage to go the way of the foolish cross. Amen.
We will sing number 436, How Great Thou Art, and invite you to stand in body or in spirit.
I see.
Good morning. We've come to the time in our service when we welcome visitors and share announcements and prayer requests. So do we have any visitors that would like to be introduced in the back?
I'd like to welcome Lewis Gosseland from Justice Together, the Justice Together movement here in Wichita and Sedgwick County. He's done a whole lot of work, and he's he hasn't paid any of us. he's gathered together about 1,000 people in Wichita and about 35 congregations or communities of faith. And he's here today to tell us, to give us an update on the progress of Justice Together. And that'll take place right after worship. So we don't have Bible study. Faith and Issues will be Mr. Gosseland talking about the Justice Together program and what we as a church can do and kind of catch up with some of the other congregations. So really glad to have Lewis here. We've known him for a long time, since 1993, I think. And he was only 5 then. and doing community organizing. It's amazing, you know, so thank you.
Welcome.
Kathy Everingham, Doug and I are the liaisons and representatives of our congregation for the Mennonite Relief Sale, which is coming up April 12th and 13th. And we have sale bills here that tell some of the activities that will be happening. Every year, the sale is a little bit different. Sometimes you have different items offered, sometimes different things happening. Last year, we had a rabbit show going on in the same fairgrounds while we were there. This year, we were advised at our meeting Thursday night that one of the buildings at the fairgrounds has been demolished in order to make room for a much larger building, which will affect the flow of people coming and going, especially from Feeding the Multitudes and Domestic Arts buildings. There are big barricades set around. It will affect you, your parking will be redirected. So we just want you to know that. But you must still come. I will take attendance. And
you will take attendance? Okay. One of the gifts that we give so willingly to Mennonite Relief Sale is our presence. And I kept thinking about all the kinds of giving that takes place throughout the year and the donations that people make, which of many. But the best gift of all is the attendance to the sale itself, because that's really where the money to help the world comes from. And it comes from those persons who attend and buy the different objects and enjoy the food and the gifts that are presented there. So we look forward to seeing your presence.
I did need to make clear about the construction. The construction will be going on during the sale on Friday. On Saturday, if you come, the construction will not be happening. There will still be obstruction, but no big loud noises and so on. If you want to run for relief, as Daryl Dirksen did for many, many years, and Cheryl Schmidt and a number of you, we have options for you to sign up for that. And we will be making pies here, and Zwieback, and poppy seed rolls, and bread, and I have those, and I will set a date for us to do that here at the church so that we don't have to heat up and mess up your kitchens. You can come here. I will try to arrange it the week ahead of us, the sale. A number of us are going on Friday the 6th to Hillsborough to make Veronica. And the purpose of this relief sale is so that those who are around the world may say that God has not forgotten them. We have been brought here, and it looks, sometimes the world looks like a jungle, but we do not want anyone to be forgotten.
And That was April 12th through 14th. Is that right? 12th and 13th of April. Okay.
Just want to say thank you, Kathy and Doug, for bringing up the relief sale. This past week, I was in Akron. This is Michelle Armster. I was in Akron for the joint MCC board meeting. So it was Canada and all of the provinces and the U.S. and all of the regions. And what was very moving and also disturbing is the places where it's not just difficulties, it's atrocities. And so we think about the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Of course, we think about Haiti more recently. We think about Gaza, and we also think about what is going on in the Sudan. And MCC is in three of the four, and I say it like that. Don't ask me who and what, because we can't do that. Because it's about protecting the lives of our workers in those places. So the work of the MCC Kansas Relief Sale goes towards that, providing people with relief. It's also helping people with gaining development, because climate issues are really causing a lot of havoc around the world. And so we are partnering with partners on a developmental, being creative about what to do in terms of development. And underlying all of it is peace and the need to really be a presence of peace. Okay, I'm gonna just say this. So I was on the plane going to the relief sale, and the flight attendant asked me where I was going. I said I was going to Akron for a board meeting, and I work for a faith-based international relief agency. And I kind of told her a little bit about MCC. And sometimes I don't say MCC because it's like, who knows MCC? I mean, you know, just say faith-based or, you know what I mean? And so I told her about it, and she shared how she was a flight attendant on one of the planes, and there were a lot of people who were here because they were fleeing issues in Central and South America. And she said, and I took Spanish when I was in, you know, high school, college, and I was able to speak a little bit. And she said, and that felt so good. And I said, you know, it's about being humans, humans being humans to one another. Anyway, get ready to get off the plane. And she said to me, which took me aback, because I'm used to hearing this from my mother, to my mother and my father, who are both military people. And the woman said to me, thank you for your service. And, you know, and I think, and I said at the meeting, at the board meeting, and I want to say here, you know, we need to, I know Mennonites hate to be proud, but but recognize that the service of peace is a service to the world that is worth being grateful for. The next thing that I want to say is, Guadalupe is asking for a
So go now with God, for you cannot go where God is not, for God loves the world. Go in love, for love alone endures. Go with purpose, daring to walk the way of the foolish cross, daring to look for God wherever you go. And God will honor that dedication. And go in peace, for it is the gift of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.